So today, Apple had their WWDC keynote, and with it, iOS 11. I've got the beta here on my iPhone 7 Plus, so I'm going to walk you through a few of the new features and changes. This is beta 1, so there's bound to be bugs, but this will give us a decent idea of what the finished iOS 11 will look like, starting with the lock screen. Starting from a cold boot, the passcode buttons are a little bit different. The unlock animation is new as well. It now slides up from the bottom. Now, before I continue, let me enable one new feature in the new control center, screen recording. Great, now that we've got that on, let's check out the rest of control center. Most elements can be 3D touched for more functions, including audio controls, and now shortcuts to functions like low power mode and personal hotspot. Volume and brightness are now controlled by a 3D touch, but unlike Apple's Home app, you can't adjust these sliders with a single swipe, but rather a 3D touch, then a separate swipe. I'd imagine they'll fix that behavior to act more like the Home app by launch. Control Center can also finally be customized, allowing for more functions like an Apple TV remote to be added in. Looking at the apps in the order they are on my home screen, Calendar alerted me to a few new features when I launched the app, but I haven't used any of these yet. Photos got some pretty cool new features as well, especially with live photos. You can now turn them into GIF-style loops, or even stitch them together to create long exposures. Your mileage may vary, though. Markup for photos and PDFs is now system-wide, and there's even a new screenshot animation to allow you to quickly doodle on those screenshots. The camera still works the same as before, but it now reads QR codes. The weather app updated its layout with slightly larger elements and a more information-dense design. The wallet app now has a white background, slightly dashing my hopes for an OLED iPhone dark mode combo this year. Notes got a pretty sizable upgrade this year, reorganizing its existing features as well as allowing more data types to be recorded, including OCR document scanning. In settings, there's a mention to the Apple Pencil, but I think this might be a carryover from the iPad. The calculator got yet another makeover in iOS 11, and I'm loving the new app icon for it. The iTunes Music Store got a new logo, but the contents inside the app remain mostly the same. The App Store, however, got a pretty large update. More work has been put into the presentation. For example, scrolling down the Today tab and tapping on the NBA Finals card gives me more details about the event, bundling two apps together. And games are given their own dedicated tab, so don't call them apps anymore, I guess. Safari received a subtle visual change in the status bar up top, but still gets a shout out because the iOS volume animations no longer block the center of the screen. It took them 10 years. The power of machine learning, people. The phone app received minor visual changes across its tabs, making it more obvious which section of the app you're in. Messages received a decent update as well, though nowhere as big as last year's. This time around, the focus is on iMessage extensions. Before you tap in the typing bar, you have a preview of your iMessage apps that you can scroll through. On top of that, you can now send money to friends via Apple Pay. Mail, like the phone app, shows larger labels for the mailbox you're currently in. And just like every other year, the Settings app is packed full of new features and tweaks. The Control Center settings have several toggles that you can adjust, and I'll probably use that Apple TV remote all the time. Accessibility now has a few new options, including color filters to reduce or increase certain colors. The new iPhone storage tab is going to be extremely useful for those phones that are at their bursting point. There's now a new offload unused apps feature that will delete unused apps but retain their user data, and message attachments can now be viewed and managed by file size or message thread. You can even get down to file type. At the very bottom of the general section is a new shutdown button. Though I'm not entirely sure what it's needed for, it's still nice to have. An exciting part of every new operating system are the new wallpapers, and with iOS 11, well, you don't get any new ones. Bummer. Oh well, I guess the final build is still a few months out. Under sounds and haptics, there's now an option to turn off haptics. If you don't have an iPhone 6s or 7, this won't be a thing for you, but I love the haptics, so I'm keeping them on myself. The 10-digit keypad for your passcode has a new design as well. The emergency SOS feature from the Apple Watch made its way to the iPhone. Nifty. There's a new tab for accounts and passwords, and man does my phone have a ton of passwords saved. Thankfully, they're locked behind your fingerprint, but can be viewed in plain text once you unlock it. The Messages tab now gives you the option to sync messages to iCloud, to back them up, and keep them the same across all your Apple devices. but this feature isn't really working for me yet. And while Apple's new OS learns everything you do, they are limiting what websites know of you with cross-site tracking. Time will tell how well this works. The camera's settings have a few more features than you would initially imagine. The app can now preserve your filters and shooting mode preferences, as well as shoot in higher compression formats to save space. I took 2 6-second videos to see how they compared. The high compression video was 20 megabytes, while the standard compression was 36. I'll let you judge the quality. The last app I want to look at is the brand new Files app. Like iCloud Drive before it, Files is Apple's solution for a file manager on iOS. But unlike iCloud Drive, Files can store contents strictly on the device or integrate with third-party managers like Dropbox and Google Drive. This is cool on the phone, but a killer feature on the iPad. Finally, a look at some of the smaller changes. Swiping down the status bar now mirrors your lock screen, even allowing the camera to be launched with a swipe left. I didn't get many notifications while recording footage, so it's a little hard to show off what it looks like, but it still lags behind what you get on Android, in my opinion. Also, the multitasking changed yet again. I actually like this change a lot already. The home screen is no longer a card, and the cards rotate faster than before. In the current beta, it's a little too easy to close out apps, though. Lastly, welcome back signal bars. Overall, this isn't the biggest iOS release ever, but it's a well-thought-out release. The feature set usually hints at what the next iPhone will bring to the table. A dark mode would have been a dead giveaway that OLED screens were coming to the next iPhone, but that's not in this release. I did, however, notice a trend with vertical real estate. Both iMessage and Notification Center use a lot more of it, making a stronger case for a taller aspect ratio, like the Galaxy S8. Anyway, that's all I have on the first beta of iOS 11. I'll be working on a video for High Sierra, or as I'm going to call it, High C, so look out for that. I had to finish this video on a stable OS before I installed High C on my MacBook Pro. Anyway, that's all for this one. I'm Jason with Maslin Tech. Like and subscribe if you enjoyed this, and I'll see you in the next one.